I love this time of year, and there's really two reasons that I love this time of year, aside from the fact that winter, it's over, well, it's supposed to be over, and so pretty soon everything's going to be turning green and the flowers are going to bloom, trees are going to bud, and aside from that fact, there are two reasons why I love this time of year. Number one, March Madness. And the reason I really like it, I don't know it so much. I was never a basketball player. I don't even fully understand the sport, if I'm perfectly honest. But there's something about the drama of the national basketball tournament that just draws me. It gets me excited. I especially like it when the coach, when the cameras will get into the locker room and we'll get to see kind of the pregame talk where the coach reminds them, hey, we're a team. Believe in the team. Here's the mission. Here's the goal. We want to win the game. Here's the strategy to win the game. And just the whole drama of it all, and especially when we have those Cinderella stories, and we love it, and we get excited about that. What I want to do today is I really kind of want us to have a locker room talk, a pregame discussion as a family. We're going to take kind of a unique approach, and I know what you're thinking. Every time you get up, it's a unique approach. But what I want us to do is just to kind of gather as a family, gather as a team, where we open up to John chapter 12, where we have a confrontation, where we have a discussion, where we see the life of Jesus, who really is our coach, and we look to my other favorite time, favorite reason for this season, and that would be Easter. Because, you know, 3 weeks from now is Easter Sunday, and that's kind of a big game day for us. It's kind of a big deal. It's when we have the most people gathering here on a weekend. We have to add another service. And it's actually a time of year where people that may not have a relationship with Jesus yet will actually come and be a part of our family for that particular weekend. So as this big game day approaches, what I want us to note first off is while we're going to talk quite a bit about the application of that day, of that weekend, what I don't want us to miss is that really we're talking about a lifestyle. Because when a coach gathers their team and they talk about a specific game, they do have some specific strategies, but they also have some things that they've been practicing. They have some DNA that makes up their team. Their coach has ongoing strategies. So I don't want us to miss that though we're making some specific application, that this is really about the lifestyle that all of us ought to live on a daily basis. Last week, Carrie talked about John chapter 11, where we have the raising of Lazarus, and we, here Jesus is on the edge of Jerusalem. He's about to come in, and there is quite the buzz. There is a huge stir. In fact, in John chapter 12, which is where we're going to be spending our time, in verses 9 through 11, prior to our text here, it says this: meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well. For on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him. There's a huge crowd here. They're all in the area for Passover. There are thousands, perhaps even millions of people. And there's just this stir going on. People have heard about the signs that Jesus has done, and they specifically are drawn to this guy named Lazarus. And they've heard that he's been raised from the dead, and the guy was named Jesus, and so these people are drawn. They want to see. But then there is also some tension, because those many people are coming to see Jesus. The Jewish leaders, the Pharisees, are really trying to get rid of them. And so we have this great drama, and I think some people are even coming just for the fact that they know that tension is there. Who's going to win? What's this going to look like? But one thing we do know is that Jesus is setting up quite the stage here. So getting into our text, starting in John chapter 12, verse 12. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a donkey and he sat on it. As it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had performed this sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." Just as we jump into the text, we can feel the excitement. We can see the momentum that really Jesus has created. Now, let's just walk through here the book of John. We remember we're walking through a series titled Believe, or It's Our Time to Believe. And we believe in a lot of really some silly things, right? But what we want to do during this series is we want to challenge you from the theme text, from the reason that John wrote the book of John, from John 20, 31, when he said, "I have written these things that people might believe that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the Messiah, and that by believing his name, you will have life." That's the whole theme. That's the whole purpose to this series. And so John pens some signs. There's five of them with a sixth to come. The first is Jesus turns water to wine, very first one, in John chapter 2. And then in John chapter 4, Jesus heals a royal official's son. In John chapter 6, he feeds the 5,000. Man, crowds are just drawing. Jesus is creating this great big ball of momentum. He's setting this huge stage. And yet, so far, he's been saying, "My time has not yet come." And then in chapter 11, he does a miracle, a sign that nobody has ever seen before, for nobody had ever healed a man born blind. And then the fifth sign in John chapter 11 was the raising of Lazarus. See, I think Jesus is setting the stage here, and it's going to become even more clear as we continue within John chapter 12. But let's just define that word momentum here for a second. The word momentum is the force that's gained by a moving object. The force that is gained by a moving object, and in this particular case, that moving object is Jesus. He is drawing crowds to himself. He is setting up a platform to make a point. And he does that by, these crowds are so big, he can't even teach. He couldn't speak to all of them. They couldn't possibly hear. Rather, there's a huge object lesson here, another, if you will, sign. And that's Jesus getting on the back of a donkey's colt and riding in to Jerusalem. Now, the people, I don't think, completely understood actually what was going on. They didn't see what Jesus was clearly trying to proclaim, which was a prophecy from Zechariah, that the Messiah would come seated on a donkey's colt. Rather, I think they probably had a little more of political agendas. They wanted to make him, set him up as a political leader, as a worldly figure. But you see, his kingdom was not of this world. It was of another world. And so far, he's kind of kept his messianic identity quiet. In fact, we can just draw back to even a number of occasions, but specifically one would be John chapter 2, when Jesus turns water to wine. Mary comes to Jesus and says, "Hey, Jesus, we've run out of wine." Apparently, she knew he could do something. And yet, Jesus says, "Not now. My time has not yet come." You see, because Jesus wanted to create this momentum. Jesus wanted to set up the stage for this moment where he comes seated on this donkey's colt. Now, the question could be asked, If the crowds largely, and it even says right in the text, even the disciples misunderstood, if they were misunderstanding this parade, this processional, as they were coming into Jerusalem, why did Jesus participate? And I love what Quest Study Bible says. It says, Jesus, at the climax of his ministry, was making a very public statement about who he is. He's the Son of David, the King of Kings, the conqueror of sin and sickness. And here it is. conquering generals at the time were given a triumphal entry on their return to their home city. But Jesus doesn't come in on a war horse. No, he comes in with more symbolism, not just on a donkey, but on a donkey's colt, where he rides in as a prince of peace. Because his kingdom is not of this world. And I think it's noteworthy to say that in John chapter 10, Jesus made a statement that I think we need to understand. Sometimes we'll accidentally throw out that Jesus was murdered. No, Jesus was not murdered. And we can say that because in John chapter 10, it says this, no one takes my life from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. See, my point is, Jesus is creating this momentum, and he is setting the stage for what's about to come. Picking up our text in verse 20. Now, there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew, and then Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, here it is, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed, but if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven, I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said it was an angel that had spoken to him. But Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not for mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. And he said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. Jesus has been saying, my time has not yet come. My time has not yet come. My time has not yet come. And here we are in John chapter 12. My time has come. The stage is set. And apparently it has something to do with these Greek men coming to seek Jesus. Greeks were known for being men of seeking minds. They were seeking something. And apparently there's some correlation as John records this, and it's interesting that John is the only gospel writer that records the event of these Greeks coming and saying, hey, we'd like to see Jesus. And I think what we can see here is Jesus again making a blatant claim that he is not just king of the Jews, but rather he is king of the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And as we can just walk all the way through the Old Testament to the New, his heart has always been for all of the nations. So as these seeking Greeks, as Jesus has created this momentum, he has set the stage as there's this buzz that's going around Jerusalem. They seek out Jesus, and Jesus says, my time has come. Now, why is it that John might record this and others not? And I think it's simply because of that theme verse. I've written these things so that you may believe. He's making a point here that it wasn't just the Jews that were believing. It was all of the world that was coming to believe in Jesus. Jesus uses this moment from the triumphal entry to the words that he's now speaking, and he uses them to proclaim the gospel. Now, there's an interesting debate, actually, among scholars. Interesting debate that asks this question. Did Jesus preach the gospel? Well, which seems kind of funny to think about. But I love what one of my favorite scholars says, Scott McKnight. He says, oh, poor Jesus, he was born on the wrong side of the cross. See, because I think what's misunderstood here is that Jesus is indeed proclaiming the gospel. But it's not a mere line of beliefs. It's not a set of doctrines. Rather, the gospel is a person. The gospel is a king, and his name is King Jesus. And he has entered into Jerusalem, not on a war horse, but he has come in as the Prince of Peace, riding on a humble donkey's colt. And in fact, as he comes in, he doesn't come in angry. He doesn't come in with judgment. He actually has tear-filled eyes. Because as he comes to this moment, he goes, "My soul's troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour." No, for it was this very reason that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Jesus lives solely as a model to us, to glorify God, to glorify his Father, to live completely obedient. And he came to seek and to save the lost. That was his mission. As we talked about at Christmas, in the shadow of the manger was a wooden cross. Because that little baby, who is now a grown man, had a narrow focus. And it was to go to the cross. You see, his full inauguration to his kingship wasn't a crown of gold, but a crown of thorns. For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and lay down his life as a ransom for many. And you can see the imagery that Jesus is using here. You can see his point when he says, unless a kernel of wheat dies, it can't produce a harvest. And we've seen that to be true in our lives. It's testimony to every single one of you sitting within here that that proclamation is true. Because as Jesus dies on the cross, billions of people over the last 2,000 years have proclaimed this death and ultimately this resurrection of Jesus. See, the gospel is not a set of beliefs, but a person. It's that we have a good king who intervenes on our behalf. The result of this gospel, this good king, is that we can have salvation, that we can have eternal life, forgiveness of sins. And he also demonstrated to us what it looks like to lay down his life for his friends. And here comes to the personal application part for us. Is in verse 25 and 26, did you catch it? He wasn't just referring to himself here, but he gives us a command. And then he models how. He says, anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Self-denial. You can hear the echo of Luke 9:23 earlier when Jesus says, if anybody wants to be my disciple, they must deny themselves, pick up their cross, and follow me. And I missed a key word in there. Must pick up their cross daily and follow me. That's our daily struggle, isn't it? Because when we wake up in the morning, we check our smartphones, we check our calendars, we check our schedules. We get our kids out of bed. We get them to where they have to go. We get to our job. We check off our task list. And in the middle of all of that, we can forget that we are a kingdom citizen and we have a king who were to wake up and serve on a daily basis, to be his ambassadors, to die to ourselves and to live and be alive with him. This whole idea of self-denial, of dying to ourselves, now that's a countercultural message, right? Rather, in our culture, we're hearing things like, believe in yourself. No. As I've said before, believing in ourselves is what got us into the mess that we're in. Rather, we have one who died so that we can have life and life abundantly, so we can experience life and life to the full, and that is our King Jesus, who speaks value, who speaks life, who gives life into our very souls. Jesus calls us to come to him, and it's only in him that we can truly find life. But really, it doesn't always make sense. That's not something we can grasp. That's a very countercultural idea. When we hear that, and I love asking the question to youth, what does that mean to die to yourself? And oftentimes there's crickets or funny answers because we struggle to understand that. So let me give you an illustration when it comes to making sense of what God has called us to. You know, let's turn to the very theologically motivated movie, Flubber. Yes, that's a joke. One of my favorite scenes within this movie is the basketball game, where the professor at the college in which he serves, his basketball team is terrible. And he has a mission. He wants to save this school, and this basketball game has something to do with that. And yet they're playing the best school in the area. They haven't lost a game in years. And so professor's like, well, I'm just going to equalize the playing field. And he takes this thing called flubber, and he creates these substances, and he puts this flubber in little tacks, and he sticks it on their shoes, and he greets them at the tunnel at halftime after he rubs the flubber on his hands. And so they can dribble the ball like never before. They're hitting the ceiling as they jump around the gym floor. And it gets down to the very end of the game. It's a close game all of a sudden. They were getting blown out the first half, but now it's come down to just the last seconds. And they called a huddle. They were coming up with the game plan. The other team is shooting their free throws. And the professor sees down in the huddle as they're coming up with their game plan, he realizes that they've discovered the tacks. And one of the players, his name is Dale, he begins to take those flubber tacks off of his shoes. And the professor's like, no, we're about to win the game. And he runs down there, he gets in the huddle, and he tells the coach, hey, I think Dale has a problem with his shoes, I need to check it out. And he goes down to Dale, and because he had taken the tacks off, he has this flubber spray, I guess, and he sprays off his shoes, he wipes them off, and he tells Dale, he gives him very specific instructions. He says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to rebound the ball, and I want you to jump as hard as you can. And Dale goes, but I'm on the other end of the court. You know, he's down at this end of the court, and he's going to look really foolish, at least in his own mind, if he gets the ball and he just makes a great big jump. Because after all, there's just seconds in the clock. He needs to get running down to his goal. And the professor says, jump or I'm going to fail you. They shoot the shot. He gets the rebound. He jumps hard, and he does backflips all through the air where he goes through the hoop on the other side. And they win the game at the very last second. You see, I share that illustration because I think sometimes, though we feel like we're going to look really foolish, though it doesn't make sense to us at all, that Jesus has called us to come and to deny ourselves. And it's when we deny ourselves and we allow him to be the life that's living through us, do we truly live the successful life as we were created in God's image, as God's workmanship? And it's in those moments of death that we truly have life, where we can begin to sow seeds and bear fruit in other people's life. A couple quotes here from William Barclay. I love what he had to say about this idea of dying to ourselves. He said this, "It is sometimes only when a man buries his personal aims and ambitions that he begins to be of real use to God." That's tough, and yet so true. And later he says, "The world owes everything to people who recklessly spent their strength and gave themselves to God and to others. No doubt we will exist longer if we take things easily, if we avoid all strain, if we sit at the fire and husband life, if we look after ourselves as a hypochondriac looks after his health, no doubt we will exist longer, but we will never really live. As followers of Jesus, we're called to live. My question is, are you living? In Acts chapter 2, Peter gets up and he preaches the very first sermon on the day of Pentecost. Very opening day of the church, he preaches a sermon and he ends it with this. He ends it by proclaiming the gospel. And what he says, at the very end, the climax, he says, "And this Jesus whom you crucified has been made both Lord and Messiah." You know what he's saying? Jesus is King. And as the crowds are cut to the heart, they say, "What must we do? What should we do? How do we respond to this King? How do we live a life as kingdom citizens with him as the king of our lives?" And he says this, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Christ Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Repent, turn from your sin, declare him as your king, turn from your sin, and be baptized. Here's one reason why I think baptism is so important, especially baptism by immersion. Here it is. You want to see the imagery? Here it goes. Here's what immersion looks like. Can you see the picture? Because our walk with Jesus begins when we declare him as king. And the only appropriate step is for us to die to ourselves, where he can resurrect us and give us life here and now. And the ultimate result is life forevermore. There are some times, and she's in the room, so I'm going to love saying this. There are some times that my wife kind of drives me crazy. Now, it's very rare, but let me give you an example. I distinctly remember when recently, when we were about to go to bed, she loves to read. She loves to read fictional novels and stories, and as we were about to go to bed, I know she's really into this book, and so I said, "It's time to go," you know, like, whatever time it was, too late. And so what I quickly see her do is flip to the end of the book, read the end of the story, because she couldn't stand to wait. Now, I don't get that. I have to read and I have to see the story unfold so I can get to the climax. But I think there's one conclusion that we can draw. As followers of Jesus, people who have declared Jesus as king and have died to themselves, we know the end of the story. We know how the story ends. Jesus isn't only king here on earth, but he is king forevermore. And we get to spend eternal life with him forever. And yet sometimes I don't think we as followers of Jesus live like we know the end of the story. So if I'm just to kind of take, let's have the family huddle time, game plan 3 weeks from now. And let me confess up front that I struggle with what I'm about to say too. But Easter really is a big game day for us. We have the biggest, not only do we proclaim the central truth, the central doctrine to our faith, resurrection of new life, now and forevermore, but many people in our community is just going to come and they're going to worship with us. They're going to come and be a part. Why? Well, because it's Easter. It's what you do. And yet, on that weekend, when we declare those central truth, that central truth, the resurrection to new life, life eternal, many followers of Jesus are more driven by their family traditions of that day than they are welcoming people to our eternal family here. we have some great examples. People that'll get here like 5 a.m. to make breakfast, and people that'll be here Saturday night, and worship teams that will be here the entire weekend. We have people, some great examples of people that have denied themselves in order to serve others. But this is game day. We have an opportunity. We need more people with smiling faces in the parking lot and at the doors. Contact Dee McCoy. She would love to plug you in. We need smiling faces sitting here in the pews, people that will scoot in and make space for somebody else. People say, hey, why don't you come sit with me? Hey, why don't we go, here it is, why don't you join us for our Easter lunch? Because when people are coming on that weekend, yeah, they know what the message is going to be proclaimed, and they need to hear it again. But what they really need is to experience that Jesus, that man, in a tangible way, living through you in the parking lot, at the doors, in our classes, in this room. So I don't know what it looks like for you to die to yourself this Easter Sunday. Maybe that means coming to our 7:30 service so you can make space later on. Maybe that means you participate in one of our ministries. Maybe that means you decide, I'm going to go to all four services simply so I can be a smiling face, so I can get to know as many people as I can, so I can get them connected. But remember, it's not just about the game day. This is about continuing to live this lifestyle. People need to experience the love of Jesus in a tangible way, and they need to see you believing in the end of the story and loving them like eternity is at stake. And can we just remember the name of our church? We are New Hope Christian Church. We have an opportunity to use the momentum, really, that Jesus has set up, but the momentum that we have on Easter Sunday to declare new hope. Man, momentum should always be attached to the name, like New Hope Christian Church. And let me give you one more specific application here. We were out at a church out in Baltimore, Maryland, this last week. A few of us went out there, and we were challenged by their leadership challenge to their church, which was this: bring 12. 12? Bring 12? Not invite 12, bring 12. They have a church of over 5,000. What will it look like if 5,000 people bring 12 people with them to their services? Let me start with this. Bring three. Find three people. You can picture them in your head. You know there are people that need to know Jesus. And what kind of experience do you want them to have as they come to gather with our family? And then be the team member that makes that experience a reality. Joan of Arc, as her time on earth was coming to an end, she knew it. She prayed to God, "I shall only last a year. God, use me as you can." We don't know how much time we have left on this earth, but may we pray the same prayer. God, I don't know how much time I have left on this earth, but God, use me as you can. May we die to ourselves, pick up our cross daily, and choose to follow Jesus. And may we be a body of believers, New Hope Christian Church, that believes the end of the story and are willing to live like it. Father God, I thank you for the truth of who you are. God, the gospel, the good news, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. But God, I just pray that we wouldn't take this Easter season for granted, but God, we would see the opportunity in front of us. We would see the chance that we have to shine your light. God, we have a great team here. And God, we have a great coach and your son, Jesus. God, may we be committed to his mission. And may we define success the way he does. God, I pray all this in your son's name. Amen.